In this video, I'm going to talk about probably my most favorite strategy RPG game, and it's on the PlayStation Portable. It was originally released for the PlayStation 2, and when it was on the PS2, it was called Disgaea Hour of Darkness. On the PS2, it's called Disgaea Afternoon of Darkness, not Hour of Darkness. It's not that much different from its PS2 brother, but it has an additional story mode. It has more levels, has more streamlined mechanics, and a new subtitle. You know, these are minor improvements to those who played the original, but nonetheless, this guy on the PSP is just as much a swan song to SRPG fanatics as Hour of Darkness was. And also, having this guy on the portable system is really awesome, because in this guy, you can't really save a level until you beat that level. And in the item world, you can't save until you got out of the item world. And that's really problematic. Because let's say you have another engagement to go to and you're playing on the PS2. You know, you want to save the game, but you just got to leave your system on. You could turn the TV off, but you got to leave your system on. You got to go to that whatever that thing you got then, and then you come back, and then you got to continue to get to that save point in order to save and turn off the system. That's on the PS2. On the PSP, you have a sleep button. So let's say you have somewhere to go. You haven't saved the game. Put it to sleep. Put it in your pocket. Go. That's what's awesome about having this guy on the PSP. And that's what's awesome about the PSP system is that you have that sleep option. On the DS, yes, you can close the game and have the sleep option, but that really drains your battery life still. On the PSP, when you put it to sleep, there's hardly any drain on the battery life. So that's what I like about having it on the PSP. The first thing you'll notice about this guy is its wacky storyline. Unconventional is the only word really I can think of to describe the plot and the characters of this guy. This guy throws away everything cliche about JRPG stories and instead presents stories that are upside down, twisted, and totally opposed to conventional wisdom, such as heroes triumphing over absolute evil. There's none of that in this guy. This fact is most obvious when considering the fact that the protagonist of this guy is Laharl, a bratty son of the demon overlord. That's the main character. The story starts when the overlord is killed, and 2 years passes by. The demon world is in turmoil, with every demon trying to claim the title of the overlord. Laharl has been asleep for 2 years, and when he finally wakes up, instead of grieving the death of his father, he's more concerned about proving to the rest of the world why he is a son of the almighty Krzyzewskoi. Who is the overlord, and he's wanting to be the next overlord. He doesn't care that his father died. You know, he's a demon. This interesting premise takes some wacky twists here and there, with plot twists that are so random and bizarre that it's obvious that the developers don't want you to take the story too seriously. The humor is crazy yet witty, and the dialogue so comical that everything serious, from anti-racist messages to the concept of protecting the earth, feels very, very subtle. It doesn't feel out of place either. It actually, the serious parts of the story, you can actually kind of feel connected to it. It's just that the actual story itself, the premise is so crazy. At one time, the Earth Defense Force makes its way into the storyline, and there's spaceships, and even there's one episode where they're called Prism Rangers. Does that sound a little familiar? It's because they're based off of Power Rangers. So Power Rangers comes into the story. What the hell? But it's so cool, it's so funny. The randomness can often be a little bit too much, especially at this previews of upcoming episodes. So their episode is like a chapter of the story. There's like, I believe, 14 chapters, 14 episodes. Might be 12, I think it's 14. After each episode, each episode has like 5 or 6 levels. There's a lot of stages in this game. It's a really long game. But after that, Etna previews the next episode. But this preview has nothing to do, it doesn't really have to do with what's going to happen in the next episode. It's just really random. It's as if Etna is making a movie out of this Gaea. But, you know, it's a movie that will never happen in the game. But, you know, it's a little out of there. It's really out there. It's really random, but it's really humorous and it's funny. And that's what's really great about the story of this Gaea. Just that it's so unconventional. But the storytelling can feel a little bit dry, because there are no cutscenes, but just old school traditional method of two characters facing each other with text boxes. However, the script is witty, and the voice acting is believable. So that ultimately, this guy's story is one of his strongest aspects. You won't find another bizarre yet meaningful story like this one in other RPGs. I think that's for sure. Unless you're talking about like the sequels. But even the sequels don't do a good job in the story department as this guy at one does. I mean, we're talking about a game in which dead humans become explosive penguins that say, dude, where nasty things and ugly are compliments, and a game where being 23, 97 years old is being a prepubescent kid. So, there's that. The best thing about the story, though, is that it's somehow it's somewhat dynamic. There are multiple endings to achieve, about 9, I believe, and the PSP version offers an alternate story world, and once you beat the main story, which would occur if Lahal was killed in the beginning of the game. So that is Etna's story, and Etna kills Laharl when he's sleeping, and is composed of 4 lengthy chapters, and this story is also an entertaining one to follow, although not as bizarre and not as humorous as the main story, which is saying something. If the main story is more comical than the side story, I mean, that just goes to a testament of how crazy and bizarre the main story is. Other alternate stories also exist when you come to unlock alternate universes, just such as the human world, because the main world in the game is the demon world, the Prinny Land, and the alternate demon world where the Overlord exists, and you have to defeat it, which takes hundreds and hundreds of hours to do. These are considered as side quests, but keep in mind that these stories are just as involving and time-consuming as the main story quest, if not more. The main quest I beat in about 60 hours, right? You know, that's a typical length for an RPG like this. But to complete all the other side quests, you're going to have to invest pretty much like 400 more hours into this game, if not more. So side quests are definitely much longer than the main story. So that's why people say that when you beat this guy's main storyline, that's when you have actually begun the game. So when you beat the game, it's where you begun the game, which is why this guy is such a time-consuming game and why it's a very hardcore game. It's not a very casual game. People who are not very into games, it's going to be very hard to get into this guy. But once you get into it, oh man, it's a pretty awesome game. Just beating the main quest itself is a lot of fun. Whew. And so, I've already spent 7 minutes talking about just the story of this game, so I guess I'll break it up into its parts. In the next part, I'll actually talk about the gameplay, which is going to take a lot of time to kind of talk about, because this guy has a lot of unique things going for it, and the mechanics are just so much jammed in there that makes it really complex, yet really streamlined and conventional, especially compared to like the PS2 edition, I guess. I read about the PS2, how it works. And the PSP version definitely added a little bit more streamlining to that. So that's what I'll talk about in the next video about this Gaia.